Hello, Malty Malt Sipsters. Ralphie here with Whiskey Review 347, part of a series on Irish whiskies here in 2013 at the beginning of March, because in a very short space of time we're going to have St Patrick's Day. So into the run-up into St Patrick's Day, we're reviewing some Irish whiskies. Just to expand your awareness, increase your knowledge, and for me to share my opinion with you, so as you've got that little bit extra dimension when it comes to selecting your Irish whiskies, because it's too easy to go for Bushmills or Jameson's and leave it there. But there's more options out there. There's interesting styles of Irish whiskey, and one of the increasingly prominent styles of Irish whiskey is what's called Irish pot still. I'm going to tell you all about that. But first of all, thanks to Dorothea for the malt mention. When it comes to pot still, Irish style pot still whiskey, the nearest point of references for many people are either Green Spot or Red Breast. Green Spot's been joined by Yellow Spot, which is a more matured version of Green Spot, and very nice indeed. And Red Breast, you get a 12-year-old and a 15-year-old. My favourite's the 12-year-old, but both are good. And the reason there's been a surge in interest in what used to be called pure pot still Irish whiskey, but they had to remove the word pure because it was basically being questioned as to how you define purity. You know, what's pure about it? This is a little bit sort of misleading. So it was changed to traditional Irish pot still whiskey, which is something you don't find with Scotch whisky. But with Irish, it's a combination of malted barley with a proportion of unmalted barley. So with Scotch whisky, it's 100% malted barley. So the barley is malted by steeping and soaking and then laying out on the floor and allowing it to germinate, if you're doing it the traditional way. With Irish pot still whisky, they're basically doing the same thing, but they're holding a proportion of the barley back so as that when it's mixed in with the malted barley, it is in fact remaining unmalted. And what happens is that the enzymes contained with the unmalted, within the unmalted barley, being amylose and amylase, are actively involved in bringing out the maximum sugar from the malted barley, which of course is converted into alcohol. But more than that, in the unmalted barley, you have a breakdown of the complex starch into flavour chemicals, natural chemicals. And this really is brought about by the process of triple distillation. It doesn't really happen effectively with double distillation, but it does happen effectively with triple distillation, which is a traditional Irish way of making whiskey, because you get a purer, cleaner, tastier result. And particularly in the old days, that cleaner taste was considered a note of quality, which is why Irish whiskey in the 19th and early 20th century was so popular worldwide, particularly in the likes of America, but also in South American countries. So you've got this resurgence of interest and awareness in pot still whiskey, because it gives you a different flavour experience. Simple as that. You get these green notes, vegetal notes, camphor, mint, and a flavour that you simply would struggle to find in Scotch whisky. I'm not saying you won't find it, but it's unusual to find it. Last time I tasted it was in a rum matured Springbank, a young one. we've got here is one of the newer, more contemporary versions of an Irish pot still whisky. It's called Powers John's Lane. John's Lane being an old distillery in Dublin. Fairly substantial one, actually, back in the mists of time. This is 12-year-old pot still. It's been bottled at 46% volume, so that's good. And also, another step in the right direction is the fact that it states in the label that it's non-chill filtered. Now, interestingly, when I added a drop of water to this, it didn't go cloudy like Scotch whisky would go cloudy. But one of the reasons for that could be that in double distillation, you get more vegetable oils, barley oils and barley solids coming through in the distillate, whereas with triple distillation, in fact, that's going to be distilled out. It's going to be left behind in one of the distillation pots. So that's the reason it won't go cloudy when you add water. I'm going to add a drop of water now, tell you all about it, and then tell you some more about something else. I recommend you don't add too much water to this. It's very nicely presented, I have to say. Inside the box, you will get this nice little bit of marketing bump. I mean, it's quite genuine, I think. It's basically a history, as I hold it out here. May as well bring it to your attention, it's all part of the packaging. It's a kind of history of John's Lane Distillery, and here you are, a nice big picture which you can iron flat, frame and put up in the wall. Yes, and if you're really keen, you can get out your watercolour paints. Mm-hmm. And have your own little personal provenance Irish whisky collectible. Lovely stuff. And now for the whisky review. Nose. Sherry perfume, quite a perfumed, wood perfume notes, black cherries, acetone. So immediately we're aware, after the sherry there's a slight solventy note. Pleasant, Airfix stroke super glue solvent note, mild rubber, very mild, some fresh sawn wood, plum jam, wintergreen, vanilla, palinka, which is an Eastern European plum brandy, and some blackcurrant cordial. So a very interesting nose. When I mention the word solvent, by the way, don't take that as a negative. As you get more experience as a whisky drinker, you become much more tolerant for less obvious smells and tastes. And in fact, it becomes part of the overall quality of the experience. Interesting nose. I'll give this a nice little turn. There we go. A double turn, triple turn. And what we're doing, coating the side of the glasses with the liquor so as that more chemicals are released from the alcohol and up my nose. Lovely. Taste wise, a sweet turning wood sour, touch of bitter, certainly sherry, Oloroso inspired. But it gives way to almost a floral, violets, lilac, heavy floral notes, and candy, floral candies, cardamom, angelica, plum wine, Japanese plum wine certainly, fennel, black pepper, mild, cognac, quite a strong cognac nature to this. lemon juice, citric acid, and Yoo-hoo glue. Here's that glue coming in again. The finish, after such a promising nose and such a decent development, the finish is really quite, particularly when you first open the bottle, is really quite tannic and slightly flat. It's only when the air gets in and starts to oxidise things a little bit that we see the finish start to take on much more confident presence in the palate. But decent arrival, decent development, but the finish just a little bit short. I'm not convinced that it's really to do with caramel being added so much as the casks in which this spirit's been maturing. But adding a little bit of water will bring out, over time, into the finish, certainly bring out more sherry notes and diminish the kind of the solventiness. Now, here we go, I've gone about the solvent. I'll give marks for this and then we'll discuss that solvent thing a bit more. Here we are, 86 out of 100, and it is a blend of malted and unmalted barley. The reason for the, no, I'll come to that in a minute, just to mention why the malted barley and unmalted barley were combined. Let's discuss briefly, just for a couple of minutes, solvent notes. Now and again you'll buy a whisky, particularly younger whiskies, that have a gluey note, a solventy note, a rubbery note, and you're saying, that's not really pleasant, I'm not really enjoying that. But in fact, once you get used to it and familiar with it, and are more ready to experience it, it actually becomes an interesting part of a beverage. What I recommend you do is go out and buy yourself some all-purpose clear adhesive, like we have here, a tube of glue. Now, proceed with caution, because in Scotland, a while back, there was a part of the drug problem was glue sniffing. People would put glue into crisp pokes and then sniff to get the fumes off the glue so as to get high. So if you're going to have a smell of the glue, keep it brief, keep it short, and be very, very careful. Proceed with caution. You do so at your own volition. I'm just covering my ass here. What I'm saying is, we're so used to being recognizing the smell of things that we associate with foodstuffs or plant stuffs, the smell of things we eat, the smell of things we drink, that we don't really spend much time smelling other things that we would not normally eat or drink, and one of them is glue. If you just take a few seconds to concentrate on the smell of a glue stroke solvent, and then commit that to your memory, put the glue away, it means that it's now in the archives. It's not subconsciously in the archives, because when we're going about our daily lives, we automatically smell things and dismiss them. We don't smell things and then consciously register them. So what I'm encouraging you to do is just that, is to consciously smell something like glue, make a mental note of it, and when it comes to identifying it and it cropping up in any that particular smell cropping up in when you're nosing a whiskey or tasting a whiskey, then you'll recognize it for what it is more immediately and more definitively. Is certainly far from unpleasant, and again, like many new flavours, your first impressions can be a little bit perplexing, but as one gains more immersion, excuse the pun, immersion in new smells and tastes, the more your brain recognizes them more readily when they're experienced again, and therefore the context changes the more experienced you get. And it's something that whisky professionals, master blenders and all the rest of it, and experts take very much for granted in many respects, because they're constantly surrounded by different whiskies that the majority of us simply don't have access to. Malted and unmalted barley. What's that about? It's about taxation. That's what it's about. Particularly in times of war. And as you don't have to read far into world whisky to know that people, the ruling classes in Little Britain have always engaged very readily in war. It's part and parcel of empire building and all the rest of it. And it's terribly extravagant when it comes to using up your national resources. And it's shockingly expensive, even if you win the war. There's that many battles involved and all the rest of it, and the best way of financing it is just to impose taxes on people. Now, they didn't impose, because it's not the British way, they're not going to impose taxes on mansions and luxury carriages and all the rest of it, and theatres and newspapers. Oh no, no, no. They always tax the people who are least able to resist the tax, your ordinary folk. And what better tax than on malted barley? It's been applied all across Britain, and certainly applied to Ireland when it was under British occupation, particularly during the Napoleonic Wars, was malt tax. You know, let's put a ridiculous amount of tax on anything that can be used to make beer or whiskey. And there was riots in England about it, because everybody was affected. Everybody who drank beer, every ordinary working person, who as usual take the brunt, the lion's share of any tax burdens, as we're seeing even now with the bank's shenanigans. That is a good Irish word. But I'm not going to digress. Back to malted and unmalted barley. One of the ways that the brewers, but particularly the distillers, could get round the burden of these taxes on malted barley was to in fact put unmalted barley in with a mix, so they were paying less tax on their product. And what they found, quite by accident, because this was never by design, what they found by accident was that in double distillation it didn't really work. So that's why you don't get a pot still from Bushmills in the north of Ireland, because, you know, it's double distillation, not triple distillation. But down in the south of Ireland, you've got Middleton Distillery, which is a triple distillation distillery, and they make quite a good range of traditional Irish pot still whiskies. In fact, at the moment, they're making every single brand that's available. There's not a lot of people know that. Although, as far as I'm aware, Cooley Distillery and Kilbeggan Distillery are at this moment maturing some traditional Irish pot still whiskey. So that'll be interesting. So it was really to get around the taxes, and it worked. It produced a very definitive style, which is appreciated by modern Irish whiskey distillers as something that's unique to Ireland, and as such should be promoted, and we should see more of. And I'll say cheers to that, because I like the stuff. As a Scotch whiskey drinker, to drink an Irish traditional pot still whiskey is something different. That's what's important about it. It's singularly different. You don't really confuse the two. So any additional notes in Powers John's Lane whiskey? It's quite heavily concocted. This is very much an engineered whiskey. I don't really think that it suits the fresh sherry style so much. Perhaps refill sherry would be more of a natural expression for the pot still style of Irish whiskey. But decent enough. Pleasant, recommend it, quite pricey, but interesting to try. Also to mention, I've had some contact from malt mates highlighting a few more Irish distilleries that are in the making. Yes, some Irish distilleries being constructed at the moment and hopefully starting to produce shortly. One of them is Slane Castle, who were basically bottling Cooley for a while, but now they're setting up a distillery to make their own. So thanks to Irish Boy 2K10 for that mention, and to Shoeboy 05 for his mention of Belfast Distillery. Now, I don't know if the Belfast Distillery is the same one as the Crumlin Road Goal Distillery. So this is an old prison in Belfast, which is being converted, or part of it's being converted into a distillery. But all good stuff, because it makes jobs, it brings visitors, and it brings identity, and it bolsters up that tradition. It's all good. And thank you to Invulnerable Pig for mentioning Crumlin Road Goal Distillery. There we go. And I'm going to conclude this review by addressing something that annoys some Irish people, and I'm just going to give a perspective on it. Now, the little fella, he's not had such a prominent role in these whisky reviews. This is Gene. Some of you may remember him from my last series of Irish whisky reviews. And Gene basically represents a cliche of the Irish. Little green men, ginger hair, perpetual cheeky grin, full of shenanigans, etc., etc., etc. Now, the Scots have basically the same similar cliches in kilted Scotsmen blowing away in their bagpipes and haggis bashing round the mountainside and, you know, grouse shooting and all the rest of it. These strong, overplayed images, and round about St. Patrick's Day, particularly in the United States, they take it that bit further and put green dye in the river, so as the river's green, and people who would not normally get drunk put on a show of being drunk because it's considered Irish and traditional and all the rest of it. And certainly it is the case that some Irish find this a little bit tiresome, and understandably so. And Scots likewise, a lot of common points of reference between the Scots and the Irish, because historically there's so much shared culture coming from the Sea Kingdom back in the 11th, 12th century. But the Scots can get a little bit weary of, you know, what's up your kilt, are you a true Scotsman? And I know I've had it happen to me. In fact, it happened in Ireland, where I was attending a swimming event and I had a big glass of water, cold water, thrown up my kilt. And even though I'd had a few drinks, I was still shocked. Sort of. But it's worth pointing out that even when the international perception of our countries, either Ireland or Scotland, is a bit two-dimensional, cliched, one thing's for sure, there's an awful lot of positivity and sentiment, positive sentiment, towards both Ireland and Scotland as individual countries. And it really shows in places like Canada, Australia, America, New Zealand. But even further afield than that, you'll find that the reputation of Ireland and Scotland outwith or separate from the Britain, whether it being the UK or the British Isles, is seen as something separate and distinctive from the homogenous British identity. And it certainly works very well in promoting whisky. So there we have it. So let's not knock it too much, folks, because is far better, whatever the cliches engaged with, for any country. It's far better that they be positive and good-natured and well-intentioned than perhaps negative, or even worse, people simply being disinterested. So there we are, mission accomplished, another review done. I shall go and get myself a nice cup of tea, put the kettle on. Incidentally, I don't take sugar in my tea, just in case I visit you one day, so as you know. And I very rarely touch whiskey until mid-afternoon. If any of you are drinking spirits in the morning, at the start of the day, I recommend that you stop doing so. Leave it to the evening. Leave it till your day is done. Leave it till the late hours of the day, when you don't have to be out anywhere or doing anything. We must always be vigilant that we never overdo, never abuse the wonderful use of this precious amber nectar. See you soon, mate mates.